This program is made possible by the Chan Zuckerberg Initiative, working to build a more healthy, just, and inclusive future for everyone at CZI.co, and by contributions to this PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
A fast-moving, invisible enemy sweeping across the globe, emptying streets and schools, grinding travel to a halt, shuttering businesses and crashing markets.
I am officially declaring a national emergency.
Turning lives upside down. We collected your questions, and on Confronting Coronavirus, we'll search for answers.
To protect the American people, we'll consider anything and everything.
And we'll look to the future and what it may hold.
The rule of the game is never give up.
Welcome to our PBS NewsHour special, Confronting Coronavirus. I'm Judy Woodruff. A virus none of us can see with the naked eye has turned our lives upside down in ways we couldn't imagine just a few weeks ago. Most of us are anxious because so much has changed so fast, frightened because so much is unknown. Knowing that, we decided to try to address some of your concerns. Over the past week, we've collected your questions, and tonight, we've invited a team of experts to answer many of them. They cover your own personal health, the economy, and how prepared we are as a country for this threat. Later, we'll also hear from Dr. Anthony Fauci of the National Institute of Allergy and Infectious Diseases, probably the most respected voice in the nation right now. But to begin, a look at how we got here.
It's all over the world. It's incredible what's happened in such a short period of time.
Only a few months ago, the disease now known as COVID-19 is believed to have originated at one seafood and poultry market in the city of Wuhan, China. In late December, health officials in that city began reporting dozens of cases of pneumonia with no known cause. The Chinese government was slow to disclose the extent of the outbreak, but officials soon identified a new flu-like respiratory virus belonging to the family of coronaviruses, named for the crown-like spikes on their surface.
We've been expecting a novel coronavirus to emerge for the last 15 years.
Peter Daszak is a zoologist who has spent years studying how diseases spread from wildlife to humans and looking specifically at coronaviruses.
The closest relative to the virus that causes COVID-19 is one that we found in bats in 2013, and there are hundreds of other coronaviruses that are very closely related to this one.
There are seven known types of coronavirus that can affect humans. Four cause mild symptoms each year, like the common cold. Another is severe acute respiratory syndrome, or SARS, which also originated in China in 2002 and has since infected 8,000 people around the world, killing about 10% of them. Yet another is Middle East respiratory syndrome, or MERS, which broke out in 2012 and 2013 in Saudi Arabia, infected nearly 2,500 and killed more than 850. That's a 35% death rate.
And this one, COVID-19, has a much lower mortality rate, but still at least 10 times higher than the seasonal flu. So it's lethal. It also spreads very easily.
The virus appears to pass through droplets in the air and on surfaces. Children seem to be less susceptible to COVID-19, and the majority of people recover without hospitalization. But it's especially dangerous for older adults and those with underlying health problems. There's currently no available vaccine for COVID-19.
The answer to containing is public health measures. We can't rely on a vaccine over the next several months to a year.
After COVID-19 spread in Wuhan in January, Chinese officials began drastic measures to contain it, building temporary hospitals to isolate cases, forcing people into quarantine, and even separating family members. But by mid-January, the World Health Organization reported that COVID-19 had escaped China, first to Thailand, Japan, and South Korea, and then beyond. The United States confirmed its first case in Washington state. And with cases growing around the globe, by the end of the month, the WHO declared a global health emergency.
The main reason for this declaration is not because of what is happening in China, but because of what is happening in other countries.
Yet, early on, President Trump consistently downplayed the threat from the virus.
We have it totally under control.
Looks like by April, you know, in theory, when it gets a little warmer, it miraculously goes away. I hope that's true.
The risk to the American people remains very low.
But it soon became clear the U.S. wasn't doing enough testing to understand how quickly it was spreading here.
We cannot stop this pandemic if we don't know who is infected.
As more cases were confirmed, schools and businesses closed, markets plunged, and late last week, President Trump announced a national emergency and changed his tone.
It's not a good situation, and I'm not even talking about the economy, I'm talking about the lives of a lot of people.
But as testing ramps up and huge parts of the country are shutting down, there's concern about whether it's too late to prevent a crush at the nation's hospitals, something already seen in Italy and Iran. Meanwhile, in China, it appears that the drastic measures taken by the government are working. Officials there say new infections have slowed dramatically, and 2 months after they took action, restrictions are being lifted, even as the full scope of this pandemic remains unclear. I'm joined tonight by my NewsHour colleague, Amna Nawaz. She is going to walk us through the wide range of questions we've received from viewers across the country. Amna, you've been hearing a lot of stories from Americans all around.
That's certainly right, Judy. We've been getting a lot of questions. Before we turn to those, though, we want to share some personal stories from some of our viewers, telling us how COVID-19 is impacting their lives and their health. First, a California man who was under quarantine after testing positive for the virus. Then, a New York woman who is sick but can't get tested.
My name is Carl Goldman, and I'm quarantined in Omaha.
I'm Teresa McPhail from Brooklyn, New York.
Not allowed to go outside my door. I only answer my door with a mask on.
I started feeling unwell on February 29th. My fever spiked to 102.5. I went to the ER here in Brooklyn and was tested for flu and strep, but was not tested for COVID. I was simply sent home for quarantine. They're only testing people who are very, very severe or extremely at risk, neither of which I am.
The mental side of this definitely has added to the stress. When my wife returned 2 weeks ago to Santa Clarita, she never had the virus, returned to Santa Clarita, and people still were shunning her.
It's really incredible that I haven't been able to be tested. If there had been a way to get early and easy testing, and I do have COVID, and again, it's unclear if I do have it, but having that knowledge would have saved me from maybe 5 or 6 days of unnecessarily exposing people around me.
I think the hardest part for me is being able to get back in nature. Just even stepping outside for a minute to breathe fresh air, or no longer looking at the four walls in my room.
And since sending us that video, we should mention Carl has been freed from quarantine. He is home and doing well, he tells us. We're happy to hear that. But both of those stories raise concerns we heard from a number of our viewers. So we have two experts here to address those questions now. Dr. Lena Wen is an emergency physician and public health professor at George Washington University. She previously served as Baltimore's health commissioner. And Dr. William Schaffner is a professor of infectious diseases at Vanderbilt University School of Medicine. Thank you to you both for being here. I want to jump right into some of these questions because we sure got a lot. Here's one now from Rachel Stillwell. She's 52 years old. She's from Woodland Hills, California. I want to get both of you to give her some advice she's looking for. Take a listen to her question.
What advice could you give to me about how to politely convince my 76-year-old mom, who lives in Medford, Oregon, and has a very active social life, that she should curtail some of her social activities with her friends that she's used to seeing almost every day?
Dr. Wen, we've heard this now from the federal government, social distancing, especially for members of that vulnerable population. What do you say to Rachel?
I would say this is for your health. and also for the health of others around you, for your health, because older people are, and those with chronic medical illnesses are in that category of the medically most vulnerable to COVID-19. And also, this is for other people too, because we know that the best way and the only way at this point to reduce the spread of COVID-19 is to socially distance. That doesn't mean that you have to be emotionally distant, but to be physically distant for other people. This is for everyone in our society to improve their health during this critical time.
Dr. Schaffner, what about you? What's your advice for her?
It's very similar, and it's time for FaceTime rather than face-to-face. We don't want to spread the virus, and we don't want to acquire the virus. And the way to do that is not to be in groups, not to be in face-to-face communication with our friends.
And all we can do is hope they listen. I want to go to another question now, Dr. Schaffner. I'm going to ask you to respond to this first. This is from Bill Christensen. He's asking now about a different segment of the population and what we know about coronavirus and COVID-19. This is Bill Christensen from Williamsburg, Virginia.
I understand that children who are exposed to COVID-19 are much less likely to have a serious illness. I'd like to know if large populations of children, perhaps in Italy or China, have been tested to determine if they've been exposed and if they have, in fact, become carriers of the disease.
Dr. Schaffner, what do we know when it comes to children and COVID-19?
Well, we're learning much more about children. Children can become infected. They don't get the serious disease. They may get a milder illness or have no illness at all. But it's beginning to become apparent that they are good transmitters of the virus, as they are with influenza. So they can distribute it amongst themselves and then give it to older persons who may indeed have these chronic underlying conditions or, because of age, be more vulnerable.
Dr. Wen, does that mean that children will not get severely ill from the virus?
Actually, we are learning new information about this every day because this is a new illness and new research is coming out. It did appear, based on the studies done in China, that children don't get seriously ill, as Dr. Schaffner mentioned. However, there are some new studies that show that young children under 1 year of age could get and do get critically ill. So it is important for us to keep on monitoring and to remember that all of us are susceptible to COVID-19. No one is immune. This is a new disease and there's no vaccine. So that's why prevention is what we have to take into account and into our own hands.
And Dr. Schaffner, we're getting some new information about the fact that here in the U.S., there have been increased number of hospitalizations for younger members of the population, not this vulnerable older population we keep talking about. What should we take away from that information right now?
I think it's very important information for young people. So this is a virus that can take a young person and put them in the hospital within 48 hours. It's a serious infection. And beyond that, you know, they can be transmitters to older people. So this is a message for the young people in our communities to get with the program and also participate in social distancing.
Dr. Wen, what's your takeaway from that information today?
I completely agree with Dr. Schaffner that this is, none of us are immune from COVID-19. We should take this extremely seriously. Young people are getting sick just as older people are, and this is a situation that we can all prevent going forward by reducing the rate of transmission and ideally keeping up with social distancing so as to stop the spread here in our communities.
And because there's so much we don't know, we fielded a lot of questions about transmission, about how people can get it. One from a woman in Seattle, Washington, Stacey Auger, she wrote in to say, how long does the virus remain transmissible on various surfaces? Does temperature or humidity affect its viability? Dr. Wen, what do we know?
We know that the virus lives potentially for a long time, depending on the type of surface. So hard, non-porous surfaces like a doorknob, an elevator button, or a table, a countertop, the virus could live between hours to days, depending on the other conditions like humidity and temperature. Porous surfaces, soft surfaces like hair and clothes, the virus lives for a shorter period of time. This is why, though, we need to practice really good hand hygiene, because we know that we're going to be touching many surfaces. It's not practical to stop touching things, but we can wash our hands very frequently with soap and water, reduce touching of our face, and also disinfecting surfaces around our house as well.
I want to play for you one more question. This is from Deborah Soach. She's 66 years old. She's in Minneapolis, Minnesota. Minnesota, and she wants to know what we know about potential long-term effects of COVID-19. Take a listen.
If someone recovers from COVID-19, will they have long-term lung damage?
We know many people may get sick. We know the vast majority will recover. Dr. Wen, do we know what the long-term effects are?
If you become very sick from COVID-19 and end up with pneumonia and on a ventilator, you do have lung damage, and that could be permanent. But we know that the vast majority of people will have mild symptoms, mild illness, will recover, and likely develop immunity to it in the future.
Dr. Schaffner, I want to ask you to give some advice, because we got this question a lot from people. They want to know, regards to their own personal health and the health of everyone around them, very briefly, in the few seconds we have left, what can they be doing right now to help other people?
Well, the most important things you can do is reach out to people who are sequestered at home, help them get their groceries, their medication, actually communicate with them through FaceTime, keep up their spirits, and remind them that what they're doing is good for themselves and for everyone else around them. We're all in this together.
It's incredibly helpful information. Thank you to both of you for being with us today, Dr. William Schaffner and Dr. Lena Wen. And thanks to all of you for your questions you sent as well. We'll have more later in the show. For now, if you'd like some tips on what you can be doing right now to protect yourself from COVID-19, here are some tips for the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention. The pandemic is not just a health crisis, it's also triggered an economic crisis, and it's already having a major impact on our jobs, our finances, and our futures.
As the fears and uncertainty around COVID-19 spread, financial markets have been left reeling.
Wall Street crashed again. For stocks, it was their worst day of trading since the 1987 market crash.
Just 1 month ago, Wall Street was trading at record highs. Today, volatility is the new normal. Trillions of dollars of market value have been wiped out, and fears of an approaching recession are growing.
The speed and size of the contraction is faster than the Great Depression.
U.S. stocks are now down roughly 30% from their recent peak in February. The crisis has all but erased the gains since the beginning of the Trump administration. Some of the hardest hit industries? Airlines and tourism. Major carriers like American Airlines, Delta, and United have been dealt a staggering blow and are asking for an immediate $50 billion injection of financial aid to avoid bankruptcy in the coming months. In the U.S., several states have ordered bars and restaurants to close, leaving millions of workers uncertain about the future.
I'm really concerned about how I'm going to pay my bills.
That concern is spreading as layoffs and furloughs begin across a number of sectors. Ford, GM, and Fiat Chrysler have all temporarily closed U.S. plants. And as the government asks Americans to avoid any gathering of 10 people or more, life in America as we know it is changing like never before. All that means amusement parks like Disney World shut down. Major music festivals and tours canceled. Professional and college sports on hold. A number of large firms have banned all non-essential travel.
We have not ever seen a shock like this since 9/11.
The U.S. government is working to pass billions in aid, assistance, and loans. The Federal Reserve, in coordination with central banks around the world, slashed interest rates to zero in a desperate effort to shore up the financial system. But the deep and structural shocks to the global economy are just beginning to be felt, from what experts call the worst public health crisis in a century.
Let's talk now about those shocks and what they mean today and down the line. Joining us from Chicago, Austin Goolsbee. He was the chair of President Obama's Council of Economic Advisors, and he's now an economics professor at the University of Chicago. Here with me in the studio is Michelle Singletary, a personal finance columnist for The Washington Post. Thanks to both of you for being here. I want to jump right into the questions because people are worried. Austin, I want you to meet Linda Elkin. She's a 70-year-old retiree from St. Louis, Missouri. Here's her first question.
I'm retired, and my pension is sinking like the Titanic right now. Is there anything the government can do to help retirees?
Austin, what about that? Is there help coming for people like Linda?
Well, yes and no. Look, as we go through a period like this, and the stock market is down and then up a little and then down some more, the The government is now talking about short-run relief that they're going to send checks out to potentially every American or a lot of Americans or all Americans below a certain income level. It will help a retiree like her more than a payroll tax cut would have, obviously, because she's just not paying payroll tax. But I think in a moment like this where the virus has taken over and the economy's in lockdown, virus economics aren't the same as regular economics, as I say. So I think the most important things are trying to protect your health. The government's got to try to slow the spread of this virus. And we got to just make sure that we don't morph what is a short-term intense pain hit on the economy, that we don't morph it into some long-run depression-like entity.
Michelle, to that point, we got questions from different parts of the population, too, who are processing this differently. I want to play you now a question from a woman named Rachel Kabagadu. She's 26 years old, and she lives in Texas. She wants to know about her future and what it could look like. Take a listen to what she said.
Is it wise to change my investing? Should I be concerned about where I'm putting my money in? Should I be taking money out of the stock market? Like, what should I do concerning my personal finances?
In all this volatility, Austin talked about, how does someone like Rachel process that?
Well, the good thing is she's got youth in her time. And so she's got decades before retirement. So I would encourage her to continue to invest for retirement, because right now, unfortunately, for those of us who are closer to retirement, stocks are on sale, equities are on sale. And so she'll get more for her money. And just make sure that she, as she's investing, that she's diversified. But I would say continue to go ahead, because this right now in this moment, it seems like it's never going to end, but it will end. Even if it takes them a year, we're going to find a vaccine, hopefully. And then things will start to slowly recover. And all that money that she put in, even though it's kind of scary now, will start to increase, because that's how markets have done historically. Even the Great Depression ended.
On that point, Austin, I've got a question from Diana D. She's 38 years old in North Carolina. She wants to know about how long this will go, what the long-term effect will be. Are you as optimistic as Michelle is?
Well, I would say yes overall. But what I would say to Diana is that when you're in an environment like this, it's not just we society, the nation, can do things to prevent this thing from turning into a long-run Great Depression-like catastrophe. And this starts with the health aspect. We've got to invest in slowing down the spread of the virus. The thing that's killing the economy at this moment is that we're in lockdown. And it doesn't mean we should just declare that it's not a lockdown. It does mean that if you follow the lesson, say, of South Korea, where they're doing extensive testing, so that if you leave your house, there's a low chance you're just going to bump into many people who have the virus and don't know it yet. The only people going into lockdown are people that have tested positive. We've got to move to that. Otherwise, I don't think the relief, just pure relief, where we hand you money to cover your bills, is vitally important. But that's not a solution. It's just burning your money to keep yourself warm. So we've got to get on a path to get out of lockdown. Otherwise, this thing could last a lot longer. But I'm pretty optimistic that if we start doing the right approach, that we could get out of lockdown the way some other countries have been able to.
You know, in this moment, we're hearing from so many people who do live paycheck to paycheck who are already losing their jobs. I want to play for you something we heard from one of our viewers, Alexa Cuppins. She lives in Denver, Colorado. She works as a concert bartender, and she expresses this anxiety and worry we heard from a lot of people. Take a listen to her now.
I can't sleep. There's so much anxiety. I can't sleep. I'm having nightmares. I don't know if I'm going to have a roof over my head next month. And I'm not scared of getting sick. I'm scared of losing my apartment. We're drowning. We need a lifeboat. We want to work.
Michelle, there are a lot of people like Alexa out there. What can you tell her right now?
Well, I wish I could tell her more and actually send her money. But here's what I would say. All of us are going through it at the same time. So be in constant contact with your landlord. Everybody's going through this. So it's unlikely that they're going to evict her. So she's got, you know, several months before that's going to be an issue. And so I would say that she's still going to have a roof over her head. I'm pretty sure about that. Cut wherever she can, non-essential expenses, and then just hunker down and just know that this too shall pass. She should file for unemployment right away so that there's some. And then that money will help her pay for the essential things in life. Right now, focus on the essentials, food, utility, and again, talk to your landlord. Utility companies are probably not going to turn off your power. So those kind of things are going to help them right now.
Austin, I'll give you the last word here with another question we got from a lot of people. Very briefly, if you can, they want to know, when the federal government acts, we hear about this money, this bailout money that could be coming, how can we be sure it's going to go into the right hands, i.e. into the pockets of the American people?
That's the critically important part. Just keep calling your congresspeople, the president, the White House, whatever. You saw the last caller, the anxiety and the not being able to sleep is very common. And people like that need to be rescued before we're going to rescue whatever, casinos and airlines and businesses. If we do not learn the lesson of the financial bailout of 2008, which is, if you're going to save companies, put in some requirements and make sure that they're looking out for their customers and for their workers, there's going to be a backlash very similar to the one that we had before, but it's going to be bigger and worse because people are really afraid for their positions right now.
It's a lot of worry and uncertainty out there. Austin Goolsbee and Michelle Singletary, thanks for being here to answer some of those questions. And thanks to all of you for all the questions you sent in as well. Remember, confronting coronavirus means not just examining where America is now, but how countries around the world are facing this global pandemic. And that is where Judy picks up things next. Judy?
What began in China has now spread around the globe. If you've lost count, COVID-19 now infects more than 170 countries and territories, with more confirmed cases and deaths every day. Outside of China, among the first hit was South Korea, which has managed to slow the virus's spread through national effort. The same cannot be said for Italy, which now has the most cases outside of China. For a look at how each of these countries is responding to this crisis, we turn to special correspondents in those countries, Patrick Falk in Beijing, Bruce Harrison in Seoul, and Hermione Kitson in Italy. And we welcome all of you to our special. Let me start with you, Patrick Falk. Tell us how China has dealt with this from the beginning, and is there a sense now that they're beginning to get it under control?
Well, I think, Judy, the best way of describing the situation right now is just that it's incredibly uncertain. The headline piece of news today, of course, was that there were no new domestic cases of infection. That's a massive step for China to take. But on the flip side, there were 34 imported cases of the disease. That may not sound like an awful lot in the grand scheme of things when you think of the tens of thousands of people across China that have been infected over the past several months. Remember, just the day before, there were only 12 new cases of infection. So imported cases really is the situation that authorities are grappling with a lot right now. And the focus is shifting away from Wuhan, the epicenter of the virus, to major cities like here in Beijing and Shanghai. These are the ports of entries where most of those imported cases of infections are arriving. And President Xi Jinping, chairing a special COVID-19 meeting on Wednesday, in fact, said that there was a real risk of the outbreak rebounding at this point.
Patrick, is the government acknowledging what was done right and what was done wrong? And do you believe them when they say this is tapering off?
Well, the central government really hasn't accepted an awful lot of blame for this. And from the very beginning, it's actually framed this as being the fault of provincial leaders of Hubei province. And it's really portrayed the central government as having come in and cleaned up the mess, essentially. And in recent days, it's really portrayed this as being a victory of sorts, saying that they have essentially reversed the spread of the virus and almost won the battle against the disease. But that is why this is such a critical time for Beijing, because if there is a second wave of this outbreak, there'll be nobody to blame at this point. And there is a lot of frustration among the people of China. They are fed up with the situation. They are fed up with lockdowns. They want this situation to be over.
Patrick Falk in Beijing, thank you so much. And now to South Korea, to Seoul, and to Bruce Harrison. So, Bruce, South Korea seems to be one of the rare success stories in all of this. Tell us how they've done it. How have they managed to bend the curve, and is it actually working?
Judy, a strong sign the public believes the government's efforts working is evident on these streets tonight. In this neighborhood, you can see a lot of people actually out having dinner and drinks, and that wasn't the case here just a few weeks ago when the situation seemed far from control. But the government's done a good job building the public's confidence, and one of the main ways it's done that is through tracing, tracking, and isolating. So it's finding people it believes may have the coronavirus, testing them, and then quickly getting them into isolation, whether a home quarantine or at a hospital, to make sure they don't get more sick and spread the virus further. And important that part of that aspect is that they interview these people, they find out where they've been and who they've been in contact with, so it leads to more testing down the road. Another key part of the effort here has been communication. I get several text messages a day from the government telling me where new cases have been confirmed in Seoul. That allows me to know where not to go or if I'm going somewhere to be a bit more cautious. And all these efforts are building trust in the government. The public here has been quite good at the guidelines the government has laid out, whether it's social distancing or following guidelines on washing hands, wearing masks on public transportation. All these things seem to be working to prevent prevent the spread of COVID-19.
And Bruce, how concerned are people, though, about whether there's going to be a second wave, whether this is going to linger and come back?
Judy, we've seen a small increase in cases, and this comes after several consecutive days where the total number of cases had fallen below 100. And that was significant because at one point, cases were over 900 in a single day. So there's been some optimism that maybe the virus outbreak had peaked here and the numbers would only fall going forward. It's too soon to say that, but I think there's optimism the government will be able to bring these under control as well. We've seen that South Korea has the robust capability to test up to 15,000 people a day. There seems to be no shortage of tests right now. Companies had been stockpiling before even the first outbreak in this country. So I believe the public is hoping the government can target these new cluster infections and prevent large outbreaks like we saw in February before things get out of hand again.
Bruce Harrison reporting for us from Seoul. Thank you so much. And now to Italy, to Hermione Kitson. Hermione, Italy has turned out to be one of the disaster stories, disaster focus points of all this. Is the government saying, is there an understanding now of what went wrong there?
Health authorities believe that perhaps the virus was in circulation for quite some time before it was actually detected. It had spread very, very quickly in the densely populated area of the north in the region of Lombardia. And while that region of Lombardia was quickly declared a red zone, it was quickly locked down, the rest of the country wasn't. So people started to travel from the north into the center and then down into the south of the country, potentially spreading the virus. So perhaps that national lockdown could have come into effect sooner. Another element that comes into play when talking about Italy's high mortality rate is Italy's aging population. We have Europe's oldest population, and the average age of coronavirus victims here is 80 years old. So a lot of people in that very high risk category.
And so, Hermione, now that this lockdown has fully taken effect, how are the medical services, the healthcare services, and the rest of the country doing? Do they feel that the situation has crested?
The healthcare system here really is struggling. It's overwhelmed. It's at breaking point. There are makeshift hospital wards that are spilling out into car parks, into warehouses. Those on the front line, those medical staff on the front line, say they'd really never have seen anything like it before in Italy. They describe the situation like a war zone, and they say they're really struggling to keep up with demand. The government here has had to put into service 10,000 student doctors 9 months before they're actually due to graduate, just to in a bid to boost capacity. So this is the second week of lockdown. We're hoping that we will see the effects in terms of the number of cases in the next few days. It's hoped the spike we've seen in the last 24 hours could be the peak that we were waiting for, and that we will see the slowdown in the rate of infections in the next few days. But if we don't see a slowdown, this lockdown will have to continue.
We are all watching and certainly hoping for the very best in each one of these countries. Hermione, thank you. And so thank you again to Patrick Falk, to Bruce Harrison, and to Hermione Kitson. Their experience is what many people are looking to figure out which direction the United States is headed. Will we end up like Italy or more like South Korea? Let's go back to Amna.
From coast to coast, scenes of a U.S. healthcare system bracing for the worst. Temporary tents standing sentry outside some hospitals, winding lines of cars for a limited supply of tests. As frustration builds, America's medical professionals are sounding the alarm about a looming crisis, likely shortages of everything from beds and ventilators to face masks and gloves.
If this burns through very, very quickly, we could be in trouble. I mean, there's just no two ways about it.
The White House call for social distancing is a crucial part of the national response.
Enjoy your home. Stay. I would just say right now, we have to get this problem fixed.
It's an attempt to flatten the curve or slow the spread of the virus enough so that hospitals aren't overwhelmed with a surge of patients all at once. Still, the U.S. healthcare system is readying for an influx of cases it will struggle to care for. There are nearly 47,000 intensive care beds at community hospitals across the United States. But even a moderate outbreak, experts say, would require quadruple that, some 200,000 ICU beds. So for now, a scramble to expand medical capacity across the country. In New York State, for example, the health department is even speeding up certifications of nursing students and calling on retired doctors and nurses to help. Health officials leading the U.S. response are urging hospitals nationwide to postpone elective surgeries.
Let's all be responsible and cancel things that we can cancel to really free up hospital beds and space.
In Washington State, the country's first virus hotspot, a clinical trial for a COVID-19 vaccine kicked off this week. Any vaccine rollout, however, wouldn't be ready for at least a year. Among the biggest concerns to date, a failure to test enough people quickly enough and ensuring frontline healthcare workers have what they need to care for incoming patients and protect themselves.
There were nurses exposed to a possible COVID-19 patient. I don't know if I need to be off until we get the patient's test result back. I'm left wondering what to do.
How will our system cope as America's doctors and nurses are hit by the very virus they're trying to fight?
And those are the big questions right now. What will happen in the U.S. next? And how prepared is our health system? Joining me here is Cheryl Peterson of the American Nurses Association, representing the interests of around 4 million nurses nationwide, and Dr. Ashish Jha, who runs the Harvard Global Health Institute and joins us from Boston. Welcome to you both. Thank you for being here. I want to get right into some of these questions because we sure had a lot. I want to introduce you to Lane Abramson. She's 54 years old. She has underlying respiratory issues. She has COPD or chronic obstructive pulmonary disease and asthma. She has a very important question for both of you. Take a listen.
As someone who has had to go to the emergency room because of the common cold, what is going to happen to me when the hospitals are overflowing and doctors have to decide who gets to live and who gets to die?
Dr. Jha, why don't you take this first? What's your message to Lane?
Well, first of all, we have to do absolutely everything possible to make sure that we don't get to a point where doctors are and nurses are deciding who gets to live and who gets to die. What I would say to her is take good care of yourself, take your medicines. If you start feeling ill, reach out to your doctor. Don't go to the emergency department, but reach out to your doctor. Just obviously try to stay away from the hospital. But I'm hopeful that if you get sick and need care, we will be able to provide that for you, hopefully anywhere in the country.
Cheryl, what would you say to her?
So I would agree. I think we are not at a place where we need to panic yet. However, we need to have our hospitals making plans now about how are they going to make these very difficult decisions that may be down the line. And these are decisions that should not be made by frontline healthcare providers, by nurses and doctors providing care. They must be made at a systems level. And in addition, they have to be grounded with our ethics. Are our decisions equitable? Are they consistent? Are they transparent? And when is the trigger to make those decisions? And when's the trigger to stop?
Are you confident people like Lane will get the care that they need, even if there's a surge of COVID-19 patients?
Yes, I believe that we are going to do everything we can to care for absolutely every patient who is in need of help. It may look a little different than when it would if we weren't in a pandemic, but we are here to care for people.
Let me ask you about some of that very important work being done by those frontline healthcare workers. I want to go to Siobhan Jones, who is among them. She's in Westchester County in the health department. They've been on the front lines as one of the COVID-19 hotspots. Here's what Siobhan has to say.
Healthcare workers who are really, you know, on the front lines, you know, are they going to become ill? Are, you know, exhaustion, you know, things of that nature. And so, yes, my biggest question is how long? I guess no one can really answer that question. How long is this going to really go on?
Cheryl, we got a lot of questions from healthcare workers. And before I ask you to respond to Siobhan, I want to show you some pictures we got in from some of those frontline healthcare workers in Washington state. This is them cobbling together protective gear out of office supplies because of a shortage they've already reached. What do you say to them? What do you say to Siobhan? What do you say to the Americans who will rely on them in the weeks and months ahead?
So unfortunately, we have failed in really doing the solid planning that would have prepared us to be able to respond in a pandemic. And now what we see is ingenuity really happening with healthcare workers. That being said, we need for our health systems and we need for nurses and others to be thinking about how are we going to sustain ourselves? How are we going to look at staffing? Are we going to shorten shifts to allow for more rest between when we have to work? And are we taking care of ourselves mentally and physically? And actually, to your first speaker, the public health nurse, we have also failed to maintain a public health infrastructure that is absolutely critical to responding to this kind of system. We can and should be better. We need to learn from this, from what has happened with this pandemic.
Dr. Shah, people will hear failure and failure and failure and wonder, are we going to be ready? Can the hospitals get the supplies that they need, the face masks, the ventilators, the staffing? Will those needs be met by what the federal government and others are doing right now?
Yeah, so let me echo Cheryl's point. I mean, it has been a failure. We've had 2 months to prepare for this pandemic. We've known this is coming, and we have not responded adequately. So if the question is, are we going to have enough personal protective equipment, masks and gloves, to keep nurses and doctors healthy so they can take care of patients? The answer is not unless we work really hard to do it. We've got to ramp up production. This has got to be a federal response. The federal government has to make this a top priority. We can have all the hospital beds we want. We can have all the ICU beds we want. But if we don't have nurses and doctors ready to take care of people, those beds are going to be useless. So I have to say, I have not seen the urgency coming out of the White House on making this as much of a priority as it needs to be.
You have not seen that yet. Let me make sure people out there are getting some of the right information in terms of how they can be processing this. Dr. Purva Grover is who we're going to hear from next. She's the medical director of the Pediatric Emergency Department at the Cleveland Clinic. She talks about how we can message to our patients. So take a listen to what she has to say.
I can tell you firsthand, working in the emergency department, I was working a shift yesterday evening. There remains considerable confusion and chaos amongst our patient population. And at this time, taking the time to sit down with them and explaining, because if you're able to explain something to one specific family, that the message sort of percolates throughout the community, and that's extremely important.
Dr. Jha, to address some of that confusion, who should be going to the hospitals? What are the symptoms people are looking for?
Yeah. So look, right now, obviously, if you're having an emergency, if you're having a heart attack, you're having a stroke, you've been in a car accident, people need to go to the hospital. That has to remain that way. If you're having symptoms, you're worried you might have COVID-19, you've got a fever, you've got a cough, the right thing to do is to reach out to your doctor by phone or by some other mechanism and talk through where you are. Depending on your risk profile, depending on how serious your symptoms are, you'd ideally would love to be able to test everybody like that. We can't because we still are rationing testing. We don't have enough tests. But it's really about working with your doctor to figure out what the right care is.
Cheryl, just a few seconds left, but I want to give people something they feel they can do. If you had to tell people, here are two things you can do right now to feel better prepared, what should they do?
Self-isolate, right? We're doing it already. Don't go into crowds. Take care of yourself. Get plenty of rest. Maybe turn off some of the social media that's hyping your anxiety a little bit. And keep your hands clean. That's really what's going to help us bend this curve.
That is what's going to help us. Cheryl Peterson and Dr. Ashish Jha, thank you very much to both of you.
Thank you.
And as you at home probably heard, we hit a milestone this week in America. With West Virginia confirming its first case, the novel coronavirus is now in all 50 states and U.S. territories. Hotspots include Washington State, California, and New York. But here is a look now at how the virus is spreading across the entire country.
Now, let's talk to one of the top officials overseeing our national response. He's Dr. Anthony Fauci, director of the National Institute of Allergy and Infectious Diseases, and he joins me from the National Institutes of Health. Dr. Fauci, thank you so much for joining us. Now that the United States has begun this massive mobilization, the country's virtually shut down, is it fair to say that Americans are starting to get their arms around this crisis?
Yes, I think as a whole, as a country, a couple of things, Judy, was they're starting to really see the seriousness of it, not only from within, when you see the new cases every single day, but looking at what's happened in other countries, in China, in South Korea, in Japan to some extent, and now in Europe, where most of the new cases that are arising globally are coming from Europe. That together with the very forceful approach that's been taking to containment and mitigation right now, I think the people of the United States, at least from what I can see, there are some exceptions, Judy, some I think disturbing exceptions, where you see pictures which are not, you know, totally representative of the country, but people in bars and in dances and in parties. If you look at the guidelines that were put out just a couple of days ago, they were decided upon because of some serious reflection about what the best thing to do for the American public. And those guidelines should really be read carefully by everyone. You know, the idea about making sure that people who are elderly, and particularly those with underlying conditions, should self-isolate, stay away from crowds, stay away from bars, all the kinds of things. They're very well spelled out there. I think for the most part, the country is seeing that. Of course, it can be inconvenient. But this is a very unique opportunity that we have to prevent something that could get very bad, to blunt it so that it is within reason that we can contain. I think we can do it. Judy, I know we can do it. But we just need to implement the things that have been suggested.
So just quickly, you mentioned China. No new cases there today. They reported for the first time in a long time. Does that give you a sense and others a sense of how long the U.S. is going to be dealing with this?
Well, again, we get asked that all the time. One cannot give a definitive date about in X number of weeks, we're going to be okay, we can go back to normal. That's the reason why when the guidelines came out, they came out as a 15-day interim guideline to reevaluate at the end of that period to see where we're going. Because obviously, this is something that is formidable. I mean, when you look at the numbers that are going up, we've got to see if we can get ahead of the curve. You know, I always say, and I believe it's true, that when you react to something and it has to do with an infectious disease outbreak, when you think you're overreacting, you are probably acting appropriately or maybe even underreacting. So I know people are a little concerned about, well, how long is this going to last? How inconvenient it is going to be? Just hold tight and let's see how things go over the next couple of weeks.
Several things I want to ask you. First of all, what President Trump had to say today about new drugs, testing for new drugs, anti-malaria drugs, for example. How confident are scientists that there's a real potential with some of these?
Well, Judy, that's a good question, and it really is a question of a balance. None of the drugs that are out there right now have been definitively proven to be safe and effective. But, and it's an important but, There are some with some suggestions, sometimes anecdotal, which, you know, not a really great controls, some in animal models. When you have an outbreak where there are no specific therapies, we were faced with this very clearly during the early years of HIV before we had no available effective and safe drugs. What you do is you strike a balance between making something available to the public at the same time you do it under the auspices of a protocol. And it could be a relatively loose protocol, like an expanded access protocol, and even do some compassionate usage, where you have a balance between getting things to people who need it, but at the same time not just throwing drugs out there that you don't know anything about. You really have to have some sort of a protocol to look for safety and to ultimately see if you can get some efficacy signal. That's what we were that's what the president was talking about. That's what Steve Hahn, the commissioner of the FDA, was talking about today.
Right. The Vice President Pence, Mike Pence, said today, COVID-19 tests, he said, are going to be available, or are available, he said, in all 50 states. But we know that they are not available everywhere where they are needed. Dr. Fauci, how long before they are there, every place they're needed?
Judy, I can't give you a date when every place in every state and every location is going to get it. But what I can tell you with some confidence, that our new embracing and partnering with the private sector and getting the state and local individuals involved in implementing that, we're going to see a very dramatic uptick in not only the number of cases that are available, tests that are available, but the number of tests that are actually done. And that's the importance, because you remember back, there were tests were available, but they weren't being implemented. I'm confident that it's going to go way up. I hesitate to say on this date, every single person who's going to need it is going to get it, because you can never guarantee that.
President Trump is regularly referring to this as the Chinese virus, and now many people are denouncing his use of the term. What do you think about that, and have you spoken with the president about it?
You know, we've had conversations about that. I mean, I obviously can't control what the president says, but the fact is I don't do that, and many other people don't. Hopefully, people will not be doing that. You know, it just gets to the point, whenever you put a designation on it, there always is a bit of a stigma associated with that.
The White House also said today that masks and other personal protective equipment that healthcare providers need, they said it's being made available quickly. But you're still hearing, Dr. Fauci, about doctors. I heard a physician just an hour ago saying, in Rhode Island, saying she's talking to colleagues all over the country who don't have enough masks, who don't have enough protective gear. How long, when is that going to be available?
You know, Judy, again, not to be evasive, I can tell you very soon, because a couple of things have come out over the couple of days. Remember, the president announced that he's employed the Department of Defense to get from their stockpile but not only ventilators, but also millions and millions of masks. Again, we don't have all the answers right now today, but everything is in motion to make a lot more of these available.
And very quickly, you mentioned earlier the elderly, those with underlying health conditions, most vulnerable. But there's also new information that younger people may be more vulnerable than previously thought. New data coming in, not just this country, but other countries. What should young people know?
Well, first of all, there still is clearly much less of a risk of serious impact in a younger person. No doubt about that. However, we're starting to see that there are some younger people, now that we know more cases, many of them have underlying conditions. We need to look at it more carefully to see how many of them actually have underlying conditions. And it isn't their youth that's at risk, it's the underlying condition. We don't know that now, so no proclamations about that. But it brings up a good point, Judy. It means that young people should make sure that they protect themselves from getting infected for two very important reasons. One, their own health. This is not a trivial infection. But number two, even if they get an infection that's mild and inconsequential for them, the fact that they're infected, they may inadvertently infect someone like a grandmother or a grandfather who's elderly, like a relative, a friend or a loved one, or anyone in society who has an underlying condition that would make them more susceptible. So, you know, you have a responsibility for yourself, for your own health as a young person, but you also have a societal, and I think in some respects a moral responsibility, to make sure that your infection, which may not bother you a lot, doesn't dramatically hurt someone else. So that's my message to the young people.
And finally, Dr. Fauci, do you have a message for Americans who are watching and listening tonight who are frightened and worried for their families and themselves?
Well, the message we have is that obviously it's understandable when you hear all of these things that are going on that you'll be frightened. The message to the American public is that we are doing everything that we possibly can to put everything in place and anything in place that would mitigate or dampen the effect of this. So again, hang in there. This is something that will pass, and hopefully will be passed with the minimum of damage. But we are all in this to try and obviate it.
Dr. Anthony Fauci, we thank you very much.
Good to be with you, Judy.
Unlike practically every other challenge we face as Americans, as humans, no one is immune from this virus. It has the potential to harm us all unless we take steps to limit its spread, to protect ourselves, our loved ones, and people we don't know. We can address its potential to do harm by, in turn, our own efforts to do good. Our humanity, the thing that makes us vulnerable to this virus, is also the thing that can keep it at bay. Which is why we choose to end on a hopeful note tonight, knowing that Americans coming together have the capacity to prevail against this deadly enemy. And that concludes our special, Confronting Coronavirus. Be sure to join us tomorrow night on the PBS NewsHour, and you can always find more on our website, pbs.org/newshour, and on our social pages. We wish you all good health and comfort. Good night.
This program is made possible by the Chan Zuckerberg Initiative, working to build a more healthy, just, and inclusive future for everyone at CZI.co, and by contributions to this PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
PBS. In an